Thank you so much for having me to the university. And I'm going to take you through, first of all, an overview of some of the areas of nanotechnology in our group. I will expand on particularly the carbon side of that tomorrow morning in a talk that's going to be dedicated to science in its entirety. And then tomorrow afternoon, I'm going to share on propelling your career, which I think for a lot of the students could really help you, whether you go into an academic or an industrial position, in really helping you to move your career along. So that's tomorrow afternoon. And then tomorrow evening, I'm talking on the origin of life, where that will be somewhat technical, but speaking about the proposals that have been made about the origin of life and what chemistry has to say about those proposals. But tonight, after I give this overview on nanotechnology, I'm going to talk about the working of God in my own life. And so you'll get this duality within my life. On this slide, is the technical slide where I'm giving you some of the overviews of areas in which we work. In the top left here, you see an astronaut fixing the outer skin of the space shuttle. And so we work in an area where we put carbon nanotubes in a NOAX resin to allow it to heat. This came up because I had been telling NASA Johnson Space Center is just down the road from Rice in Houston, Texas, that they needed to be able to do remote repair in space. Then after a spacecraft had gotten a hole in it and then broke up actually over the state of Texas upon reentry, they came back, they said, okay, tell us how we can do this kind of repair. Because what happened is they were using a NOAX resin, which looks a lot like the silicone putty around your bathtub caulking. It was your bathtub caulking. And they would put that in the repair, but I knew that you had to heat that up to 1,000 degrees centigrade in order to cure it, in order for it to harden. So I said, how do you get it to harden like that when you're in space? They say, well, we would hope it would cure upon reentry. So think about that. And so it turns out that we could put 3% by weight multi-wall carbon nanotubes and just hit it with 30 watts of microwave power. Your kitchen microwave oven has about 1,200 to 1,500 watts, so just 30 watts. Power is very expensive in space. And so we would just expose it to about 30 watts. The nanotubes would get extremely hot, heat the composite, and we could cure it in about 300 seconds. In 300 seconds, it would hit 1,000 degrees and cure. That's not really the microwave gun. We developed a microwave source for this, but even I wasn't allowed to see the gun. They thought this was really proprietary. So that is actually a water gun that I photoshopped in. But it's just there to give you the sense of what they do. This is another project for us. This is where we learned how to make graphene at room temperature in the air. This is really important because most graphene is grown at 1,000 degrees on copper or nickel, where you have the thermodynamic stability. Most stable form of carbon will form on copper. And so, for example, if we were to do it here, this is a roach leg on a piece of copper being slid into an oven. We heat that up to 1,000 degrees, and that roach leg turns into graphene. Beautiful monolayer graphene this way. All the other elements like the iron and the sodium and the magnesium stay on the top, and the carbon migrates around to the other side of the copper. That's how most graphene is grown, is at 1,000 degrees. But here we learned how to grow graphene in the air at room temperature using a laser. And just the same kind of laser writer, that laser pattern system that you have in your machine shops here, things that cut out little metal plaques and things. And we just turn down the power, and this turns out to be a huge area because we've turned this into flexible electronics that are transitioning to industry, which is the topic of tomorrow morning's talk, and I'll talk about this. And you see how we've built this into supercapacitors, which are like batteries, but they charge much faster. Supercapacitors not only have high energy like a battery, but also high power like a capacitor, and they charge very quickly. We've learned how to split carbon nanotubes longitudinally. Well, what happens is when we do this, once they split, you get graphene, sheets of graphene. So if you take a straw and you just split it and splay it out, now you would have a sheet. Now you have these ribbons of graphene not in regular disks, but in ribbon form, because those of you who are here who are material scientists will well understand that when you have a long, thin object with a high aspect ratio, meaning that its length is much larger than its width, then you can use very small amounts of this and get percolation or get a network over a surface. If you use disks, you have to coat 60% to get a network over the surface that you can conduct through. But when you have long, thin features, you can do this at a fraction of a percent. This has been licensed by a company called EMD Merck. It's the materials division of the big pharmaceutical company Merck. We've used this in certain applications. Here's one application where we've used it, and we use it for de-icing. This is something you folks here appreciate much more than they do in Houston, Texas. This is a piece of glass that's being de-iced in a minus 20 degrees centigrade box. As soon as the water drips off, it refreezes in this pan here because it's at minus 20 degrees centigrade. And so you can de-ice now, and you'll see stuck to the back of this glass is a thermocouple. There's a thermocouple, and I'm sorry that it blacked out, but there was just a thermocouple measuring the temperature. But what this allows us to do is it allows us to de-ice front windows just by flipping a switch without any lines like you have in the back window. So you can do this before the blower in the car gets hot. You people understand the value of that. In Houston, they don't know what I'm talking about. We've learned how to grow graphene and then grow nanotubes seamlessly from that graphene. You think, oh, how esoteric can you get? This has been licensed to a company, and this gives electrodes now with extremely high surface area. We get 2,600 meters squared per gram surface area off of a little electrode now. We have brought lithium batteries to the theoretical maximum of what lithium can deliver. What is that? Related to your cell phone battery, which is a graphite lithium battery, when we put this with lithium, we get 10x higher capacity and much faster charging. So imagine your cell phone, instead of charging once a day, you charge once every 10 days, and you charge it in 5 minutes. How would you like that? So this is what this can do now. So this has been licensed to an Israeli company, which is commercializing this, both for batteries and supercapacitors, because it's a much higher electrode surface area. We build sensors for the oil field. I've been to Calgary many times. Houston is our nation's energy capital, much like you have your capital here in Canada. And so we built sensors that you can pump down hole, and then when they come back up on the production side, they tell you how much oil is down there. Because 30 to 70% of the oil is left down hole. And you say, well, why don't they just bring it out? Because they don't know how much to invest to bring that out. They don't know how much is left down there, so they just leave it there. So these sensors go down and they tell you how much oil is left down hole. This is a 5 grams of graphene quantum dots. Quantum dots cost $1 million per kilogram. We have learned how to make quantum dots from coal. The coal costs $60 per ton. We do it in one step in 25% yield and generate a product that you can sell for $1 million per kilogram. Now, there's not a demand for a large amount at that price, but so what this does is it changes the industry now. Why do I care about quantum dots? Quantum dots fluoresce. That means that you shine light on them and they shine light back at you. It's much like if I were to take a white shirt and go into a nightclub and they had a black light, my white shirt would glow. The reason it glows, people say, wow, nice shirt. Why is that? It's glowing, and the reason it glows is because as the black light hits it, that's in the UV, it's exciting it in the ultraviolet, and then there's a fluorophore in there, there are organic compounds in there, that will emit the light in the visible spectrum. And so it's actually shining light back at you. Where did the fluorophores come from? Well, when you wash your clothes in Tide, they get fluorophores so that the clothes come out brighter. The problem with fluorophores, if you walk around in the sunlight for 10 minutes, they will photo bleach and no longer be active. You go in the nightclub and your shirt won't shine as much as it did before you walked around in the sun for 10 minutes. That's what happens to fluorophores. Quantum dots don't stop emitting. They don't decompose because the method of emission is different than the method from an organic fluorophore. So now you could think of putting it in carpets and upholstery, things that you can't just routinely wash again, or even in clothing, and they're non-toxic. It's a beautiful area, and we just got this from coal. This is where we take asphalt. Yes, asphalt that you put on roads. We take asphalt and we mix it with potassium hydroxide, heat it up to 700 to 900 degrees, and what happens is you get out a porous structure. At those temperatures, the hydroxide reacts with the carbon to form CO and CO2 and forms little bubbles in there. It's much like when you make cupcakes. You add baking soda to the cupcakes rise, you break open the cupcake, you see all those little holes. Hey, where'd the holes come from? You formed CO2 when that baking soda, that sodium bicarbonate was heated up, formed CO2, formed bubbles, and formed those bubbles inside the cupcake, which is what gave it that rise and that pattern in there. We do this at the nanoscale in asphalt. Well, why do we want to do this? Because this traps 140% by weight CO2. The way you remove CO2 from natural gas as it comes out of the ground is you use an aqueous amine solvent, which is toxic, corrosive, and it pulls out 13% by weight. We pull out 140% by weight, and this is what's called a pressure swing adsorption process. So there's no thermal budget. You just swing the pressure. Under higher pressures, it absorbs. Under reduced pressure, it goes away. And you can pump it back downhole or offload it to a ship, whatever you want to be able to do with it. And this is an entirely reusable material. This has been licensed by Apache. Apache is a $40 billion oil company that's based in Texas for removing CO2 from natural gas. This is a thin film supercapacitor. This thin film supercapacitor, this technology has been licensed to a company that makes supercapacitors for electric vehicles, because what they've learned is that people will pay a lot to accelerate quickly, get a big Mercedes engine just so that you can accelerate faster than the person next to you. Most of the time, you're just driving at a constant, simple rate. But it's for acceleration, people will pay a lot. So if you just have a battery-powered car and you put in supercapacitors just for the acceleration and then have those rapidly recharged from the battery, that's what these are going to be used for. We have another version of this, which is going to be used in smart cards, licensed by another company. This is graphene oxide. If you just take graphite, we developed a process where we take graphite, we just treat it with potassium permanganate and sulfuric acid, with a small amount of phosphoric acid, and we get a very high yield of graphene oxide, which is just single layers, single carbon atom thick is graphene, and then oxygenation on both sides, so you can form a true solution. It is not a dispersion, it's a true solution. It's heavily anionic, and you get a layer of water on each side, and it's a true solution. So that's been licensed also by EMD Merck, but there's another company that licensed this for another application that we found, where it removes radioactive material from water. That's a real problem when you have water floods. It's a real problem also here in Canada in the oil industry, where you have radioactivity in the water. You go deep in the ground and radioactivity comes up. In Canada, just like in the US, you're not allowed to pump that radioactive water back downhole. You say, well, that's where it came from in the first place. We're not allowed to pump it back down. So it's a huge cost in disposing of that water. This removes the radioactivity extremely well. Here's what the graphene oxide does relative to three materials that are used commercially now. So that's translating through a company called Zonko. We have another project where we've made transparent, flexible electronic memory. And this is for what's called resistive random access memory based on silicon oxide. And we can put it on a flexible substrate. This is a polyethylene terephthalate strip that's been licensed by a company to make truly 3D memory. You'd say, well, why do you want transparent memory? Why would you want it? It's as Steve Jobs said, you never ask the public what they want. They don't know what they want. When personal computers came out, people thought, why do I want a personal computer? There's a computer at work, we got a mainframe, why do I need a personal computer? Well, then people got their personal computers and said, I really like this. Then laptops started coming out, people said, why do I want a laptop? I don't care about a laptop. Well, I might lose it. I want my computer right there on my desk at work. And then you get a laptop, you say, well, this is really great. Well, why do I want a tablet? I got a laptop, I want a tablet. Now you get a tablet, now I understand why you want a tablet. It's the thing you can just carry it around a lot easier. This is going to be terrific because you can make smart glass, you can make glass with functionality. Imagine all the electronics for your cell phone embedded just in a plastic strip. Then you can just roll up the plastic strip and put it behind your ear, anything you want to be able to do. You have the electronics in the plastic strip or in the glass. The main building material, if you look at any skyscraper, it will have building material, it's all glass. You don't see bricks and mortar on skyscrapers anymore. It's all glass. If you can build within that glass functionality, memory, you build electronics in the glass, you have a lot more functionality in real estate to do it. This is another project where we do drug delivery. This is where we had a mouse and we did a tail vein injection. We targeted this tumor. There was a tumor here that looked just like this one, and it targeted right here. So that's been translated to a drug company now. We're using 1/50th to 1/250th the amount of chemotherapy agent that's used in this is in a standard format. So we take the same chemotherapy agent, but with a targeted drug delivery, we only need to administer 1/50th to 1/250th. So what happens is the animals never get sick during the chemotherapy. They keep growing and they're happy. It's like when you have a urinary tract infection, you go to the doctor, you get penicillin, within a day you're feeling better, and you don't even know you're being treated. That's how treatment ought to be. You go in for chemotherapy and you dread the treatment as much as you do the disease. But when you have very small amounts of it that just go right to the target, you don't need very much. So it changes the industry. We've developed materials that are for traumatic brain injury and stroke. Traumatic brain injury is the number one disabler of young adults from falls and car accidents. Stroke is the number one disabler of older adults. It's all because of the same thing. It's ischemic tissue where you have tissue that has gone vacant with oxygen and then a reperfusion injury when oxygen comes back in. We can make a brain that has lost this much material be back like this material using these nanoparticles which sequester superoxide. And the last project I'll tell you about is our nano cars. These are single molecule cars with these motors. This motor spins at 3 megahertz, which is 3 million rotations per second, when you shine a light on it. These are so small that we can park 30,000 of them across the diameter of a human hair. That's how small they are. Why do we want to make these? You come back tomorrow night, I'll tell you why we want to make these. And I'll show you what's involved in building a nano system like this. How do you take molecules and put them together to build you a nano system? And so you can actually see these cars on surfaces moving out across surfaces. So that's the nanotechnology. There's my current research group, and there's my current research family, and I have many others that have done beautiful things and gone on from here, like Ali, who's here, who spent some time in our group and visited with us for, was it like 8 months or a year? Yeah. Something like that. So we have lots of very, very talented visitors that come and do great things and make me really look good. People read the publications and they never remember the names of the students that did all the work. They only remember one name on the papers. So it's like it's not fair. But that's just the way academic life is. And these are the folks who do this, and I really love them. They are great and fine people, and they're the ones that have done all the work that I've told you about. But how did I become interested in chemistry? Well, it started this way. I wanted to be a New York State trooper. That means a policeman. Drive up and down the highway in a big car. That's what I wanted to do. But I was colorblind and I couldn't get into the academy. At that time in the United States, you couldn't be colorblind and be a state trooper. Now I think you can be a paraplegic and be a state trooper. But at the time, you couldn't even be colorblind. So I wanted to study forensic science. And so my father said to me, he said, instead of studying forensic science, why don't you just get a general degree in chemistry? And after you get that degree, then you can specialize in forensic science. And so that was my father's advice. And what amazes me is that at the age of 17, I took my father's advice. And then I got into this field of organic synthesis, and I thought, this is remarkable. To show you how much I loved organic synthesis, there's a big textbook, organic chemistry textbook, usually about 1,200 pages. Doesn't matter what school you're in, it's all the same, 1,200 pages. And the professor will assign certain problems at the end of the chapter. I would do all of those problems. Then I would do all the problems that the professor didn't assign. All of them. Every problem in the book I would do. And I would find an empty room on Friday nights when people did many other things on Friday nights, and I would just work organic synthesis problems. I loved it. Something got into me. And I loved molecular structure, and I would look at structures, like this is strychnine. I would look at structures, and I would remember them. I can't remember names very well, but if I could just paste an organic chemical structure on everybody's forehead, I'd remember them. And these just spoke to me, these sorts of arrangements of atoms. And molecular structure in everything that I see, that's what I see. So whenever I look at something, I look at a table, I know exactly why a table has the properties that it does, because of these carbohydrate strands, which are these carbon strands that have hydroxyl groups hanging off them that give these intermolecular forces that allow it to be somewhat flexible, yet quite a tough material. Why a carpet fiber has the materials that it has the materials properties that it has. So I see molecular structure in everything. That's going to become very important in our conversation tomorrow night. Now, how did I come to faith in Jesus Christ? Well, I'm not a theologian and I'm not a philosopher. So if you ask me questions about theology and philosophy, you're going to get a dazed response. That's not me. I was 18 years old, and that's the first verse that I remember reading. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. There was a young man in a campus ministry on the Syracuse University campus. I was 18 years old. I was doing laundry in the laundry room in the end of August, first load of laundry, and I started talking to him, and he was on the Syracuse University football team, and I asked him if he wanted to play pro ball when he graduated. He said, oh no, I'm not good enough for that. I said, what do you want to do? He said, well, maybe lay ministry. So I don't know what lay ministry is. What is that? He said, sort of like a missionary. I said, a missionary? We don't need missionaries. We got TV. This is 1977. Why do we need missionaries? So he said he wanted to give me an illustration of the gospel. I said, sure, you can do that. And he had me read this verse. And I looked at him and I said, I'm not a sinner. And he was kind of shocked by this, but I grew up in a Jewish home, a secular Jewish home, and we don't reflect on sin. We don't think about it. You become a Christian, every action you wonder, uh-oh, maybe I've sinned. Jews, it's much simpler. You go to the synagogue once a year, we're good to go, you know, you just try to be good. Do the best you can, you know. And I said, I'm not a sinner. He says, you've not sinned? I said, no, how could I be a sinner? I never robbed a bank, I never killed anyone. How could I be a sinner? So he had me read through a list of verses, but after this one he stopped and he turned to a passage where Jesus said in the Gospel according to Matthew, he says, if you've ever looked at a woman with lust for her, you've committed adultery with her already in your heart. And I said, gulp. I was 18 years old. And I was already addicted to pornography because when I was 14 years old, I started working in a gas station just outside New York City on the highway, and the salesmen would throw away their magazines in the parking lot on Friday nights on their way home. And I took their magazines and I became addicted at a very young age. And all of a sudden, a man named Jesus Christ, who lived 2,000 years ago, called me out. And I felt as if I had been punched in the stomach. And so I listened to him with the next verses after he said, but I say to you that everyone who looks at a woman with lust for her has already committed adultery with her in his heart. But God demonstrates his own love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. I didn't even know that there was a claim on the table that Jesus died for me. I didn't even know it. Grew up as a Jew in a Jewish community in New York City. The only people who were not Jews in my elementary school were the African Americans. They were bused in from the projects because that was the year that New York State started integration, the year that I started kindergarten. And so either you were Jewish or you were not Jewish and you were black. That's all I knew. But I never had any real religious upbringing. Then he drew this picture for me where he had people on one side, God on the other, separated by sin, and that Jesus Christ, when he dies for us, provides a way for us to bridge this to get to God, that our works keep falling short. And so then there was the night of November 7th. So he shared with me in August, November 7th, 1977, I was in that room. Room 1812 of the Lawrence and Dormitory at Syracuse University. I was all alone. My roommate wasn't there. And I don't know what prompted me to do this. I'd never seen it in Judaism nor in Christianity. Christians usually sit when they pray. Jews generally stand when they pray. And I got down on my knees. And I said, Lord, forgive me because I am a sinner. Forgive me. And I felt all of a sudden a presence and this burden that I had carried since the end of August, that now I am a sinner, begin to lift from me. And I remember opening my eyes in shock because somebody was standing in my room. And I opened my eyes to see who was standing in my room. And I couldn't see anyone, but somebody was there. The presence was too real. And I started weeping, and I wasn't scared of the presence, but it was so overwhelmingly kind in accepting me that I didn't know what to do. I couldn't get up off my knees. All I could do was just thank God for what was happening in my life. There was a presence of somebody standing in my room. I didn't know what was happening to me. Something happened that night. I didn't tell anyone. What's this kid from New York City going to say to people? This Jewish kid. And I remember about 2 weeks later, the guy that had shared with me in the laundry room several months before looked at me and says, Jim, have you accepted Jesus in your heart? I said, I think I have. Why do you ask? He says, you haven't stopped smiling for weeks. Something happened to me at that moment. And I asked him, how can I keep this closeness with God? This was all new to me. I loved it. He said, I've talked with many people, and he said, if you read your Bible, I've talked with many Christians, and I've spoken with them, and I asked them, for the ones that seem to always have a deep relationship with God, do you read your Bible every day? And they'd say yes. And then I talked to other Christians that seemed to have very little going for them in life that was different than any unbeliever. And I've asked them, do you read your Bible every day? And they say no. I say, this I can understand. It's digital. You read your Bible every day, you stay close to God. You don't, you won't. Set a pattern in my life. So I started reading the Bible every day. So shortly after that, I started on a pattern where I would start in Genesis chapter 1, verse 1. That's page 1. And I would read all the way through to Revelation chapter 22. When I was done, I would start again. Not quickly, I would just start reading where I left off the day before, saying, Lord, speak to me. I've been working on that same pattern all my life since that time. Every day, I read the Bible, and I just pick up where I left off the day before. I also had these four men invest themselves into me. Dr. T.E. Koshy was the evangelical chaplain at Syracuse University. He introduced me to a man named Brother Bak Singh, who started over 600 churches in India. Greatly influenced my life. Professor Del Brosma, who was a professor at Purdue University when I was doing my PhD there, was also the pastor of our church. And Professor Buck Hatch at Columbia International University became a friend of mine. These men invested into my life. This is why I invest back into students' lives. Things started to change. This is a summary of the gospel. If you've never heard the gospel, this is a one-sentence summary. Now, if you look in the original Greek, the sentence is, it's meaningless that it's one sentence in English, but it's interesting that it's one sentence in the New American Standard Bible. It says this, for the grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation to all men. This is for everyone, bringing salvation to all men. Instructing us to deny ungodliness and worldly desires and to live sensibly, righteously, and godly in the present age. What he calls us to do is to live differently. You can't live any old way anymore. He calls us to deny ungodliness. It is a constant, intentional decision to deny ungodliness and worldly desires and to live sensibly, righteously, and godly in the present age, looking for the blessed hope and the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior, Christ Jesus. This is touching on the fact of the resurrection, the physical resurrection of Jesus Christ. Jesus has risen physically from the dead. It says in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, that I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day according to the Scriptures. So Paul tells us, this is the most important thing of the gospel, the physical resurrection of Jesus Christ. If he's not raised physically, the Bible says, we are of all men most to be pitied. I've studied the resurrection over and over and over again. I've studied the resurrection, studied the accounts, the historical accounts, the historical proofs. The fact of his resurrection is so overwhelming that Jesus has risen from the dead, who gave himself for us to redeem us from every lawless deed. Jesus redeems us by himself to purify for himself a people for his own possession, means I belong to God now. Zealous for good deeds. Every other religion, you do good deeds with the hope that your good deeds will outweigh your bad deeds and somehow you'll get into heaven. In Christianity, it's totally unlike that. The Bible says there's nothing you can do to get yourself into heaven. Nothing you can do. You can't work yourself. Your works will always fall your works will always fall short. It says in the book of Ephesians. But what he does is he saves us and then says, now go do good deeds. Every other religion, you do good deeds to get saved. In Christianity, you get saved to do good deeds. He says, now go and do the good deeds. This is the pattern. What are the results of that decision that I made to follow Jesus? Well, I started striving to overcome sin. Now I knew what sin was, and I wanted to overcome sin. I started studying the Bible daily, and I read very slow, pensively, saying, Lord, speak to me through this passage. And he speaks. The Word of God speaks. You tear out every page in your Bible that says, God said, God spoke, and you'll have almost no pages left. This is the demonstration that God speaks. I started seeking like-minded friends. I joined a church where I was mentored by godly men. I started praying that God would provide the wife that he had for me. I prayed very specifically that God would provide me with the wife that he had for me. I have a treasure of a wife. When I got married, I had no idea what a treasure she was, but God knew. Been married almost 34 years. I've never heard her say anything bad about anyone. I mean, I say bad things about people like every hour. She is amazing. Just amazing. Giving, loving, warm woman. If you've not prayed for your future spouse, you're making a big mistake. Because your hormones can speak to you all sorts of things. I think you ought to commit it to prayer. I actively started praying for God's blessing upon my studies. I started praying. I was struggling in freshman chemistry because one advisor in his infinite wisdom thought, oh, he's a chemistry major, put him in with the honors class, the honors chemistry students. I didn't need to be in with the honors students. I needed to be in with the masses. The honors students had been studying chemistry, it seemed like, from kindergarten. I was just a regular student. And I was having a terrible time in freshman chemistry. When I came to the Lord November 7th, 1977, things started to turn around. I ended up getting a B+ at the end of that semester. I ended up number one in my class by the time I graduated of all the students in chemistry. I took every course, every graduate course in organic chemistry as an undergraduate. And I was number one in all of those classes as well. I know what God does. God answers prayer. And I prayed specifically for my classes, and I pray specifically over my chemistry. And if that bothers you, that's fine. Let it bother you. Don't pray over your work. That's fine. But what I pray is, all the blessings you could have had, oh Lord, let it not go to waste. I'll take them. Just heap it upon me and my work. I'll take them. That's my family. This is, to me, the blessing of the Lord. This is my wife, Shireen. This is my oldest daughter, Umbreen, and her husband, Philip, and their two girls. This is my next daughter, Sabrina, my son, Josiah, and my youngest, Ben. And this, to me, is just the blessing of God. And a testimony that I have that many men my age would love to have is this. It's not that I love all my children, nothing special about that. But all of my children love me and enjoy being with me. That to me is a great testimony of what the Lord has done in my life. That we get together and I enjoy being with them, but they enjoy being with me. What's the impact of the scriptures upon my career? Well, there's this admonition to change my words and my actions. It says in Proverbs, "Do not let kindness and truth leave you. Bind them around your neck. Write them on the tablet of your heart. So you will find favor and good repute in the sight of God and men." I can have a good reputation and favor in the sight of God and in the sight of men if I don't let kindness and truth, I must be honest and kind. If I bind it around my neck and write it on the tablet of my heart, I'll find favor and good repute in the sight of God and men. That's a promise. I want to take hold of that promise, and I've seen it. I've been walking into meetings sometimes saying, "God, just bind that kindness around my neck. Let me not lose my temper. Bind it around my neck. Let me walk in truth." In the words that I use, but also in the things that I do. This whole thing about being truthful. I'll give you an example. My first computer as an assistant professor was a Mac SE. It was amazing. It had 1 megabyte of RAM. I mean, 1 megabyte of memory. It was amazing. And I remember then we got another computer for the lab. The next year was a Mac SE 30. It had 30 megabytes of RAM. And then we got as my group grew, we got another computer. And so I bought a set of Microsoft software for each one of those computers. And one of my colleagues said, he came in and says, "What are you doing? Why don't you just take the software from this computer, put it on that?" Because in those days, computers didn't speak to each other. I said, "Oh, no, no." I called up Microsoft and they said I couldn't do that, that I had to buy a set for each computer. So I bought a set of software and also the ChemDraw program, structure drawing, I bought it for each computer. He said, "You're crazy." He said, "No, this is what the companies say is the law. When you get this, you can't put it on other computers." At the end of fiscal years, my program directors who were funding my program would call me and they would say, "We have some extra money in the program. Can you use it?" I mean, God was just pouring out blessings on my work by being honest about it. I will never keep software. I will never keep music on my iPhone that I don't own, that I haven't paid for or is not freeware. It will not be on my phone. I don't want to miss God's blessing. I want to be honest right down to everything. As best as I can be, I want to be honest with it. I have received so much blessing for honoring license agreements when other people have been losing out. This is what I'm talking about. Truth shall not leave us if you want this blessing. The admonition to value my family. Let your fountain be blessed and rejoice in the wife of your youth. That I am to rejoice in the wife of my youth and treasure and protect that relationship. Steps that I would make to protect the relationship. There is never a young woman, a student, a female student that comes into my office where the door is going to close behind her. I have made a commitment. There's a young, a female walks in my office, the door stays open. My secretary knows it. I'm not going to touch her, but I don't even want the appearance of evil. So the door stays open. There are steps that I take to do that. Train up a child in the way he should go, even when he's old, he'll not depart from it. That I was going to wake up every morning and have a devotional time with my children. And I would get them up at 5:30 in the morning, and we would have our family devotional times where we would read from the scriptures. We would get on our knees and pray for one another, and we'd practice the scripture passages that we were memorizing together. Then I'd pray for them all, and I was out of the house by 6. And I came home at 6 in the evening, so I was gone 12 hours a day. But I had that 30 minutes in the morning with my family. And I was home in time for dinner. And then after dinner, I would start putting them to bed, starting with the youngest. My wife would clean up the kitchen. I'd put the kids to bed, starting with the youngest, working my way up to the oldest. And then as they got older, they would just put me to bed. But this is the home life that we had. This is what was happening in our home. We had the daily family prayer times, and it was hard work, but I implored God to help me to raise my children because I found parenting was the hardest thing. I mean, I wanted to raise good children. And my colleagues have asked me how. There's Rick Smalley, who won the Nobel Prize in 1996 in chemistry for the discovery of Buckminster fullerene. He used to ask me how. He said, Jim, how do you do it? I mean, he didn't have nearly the home life that I had. He had several broken homes. So how do you do this? He came to know the Lord in the last couple of years of his life before he passed away of leukemia. And this is something that your colleagues will really admire in you. You want to stand out in the crowd? Get a good family life. You'll stand out because that's what everybody yearns for. The admonition to fear God and keep his commandments. The conclusion when all has been heard is fear God and keep his commandments because this applies to every person. Jesus said, if you love me, you will keep my commandments. He said, if you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love. How much more explicit would you like the man to be? You want to abide in the love of God, you keep his commandments. That's what he said. You abide in God's love. That means you just showered in it. There's an abode. You're abiding in it if you keep his commandments. If you don't, you won't. If you want to be showered with his love, you keep his commandments. Does science make faith obsolete? Science has never shaken my faith. Never. This is Lord Kelvin. We name our Kelvin temperature scale after him. He was a thermodynamicist. I have long felt that there was a general impression that the scientific world believes science has discovered ways of explaining all the facts of nature without adopting any definite belief in a creator. I've never doubted that that impression was utterly groundless. Science actually strengthens my faith. Lord Kelvin said this, the more thoroughly I conduct scientific research, the more I believe. Science excludes atheism. If you think strongly enough, you will be forced by science to believe in God, which is the foundation of all religion. There's an excitement for scientists with faith. Ronald Ross discovered that the malaria parasite lives in the mosquito stomach. In 1897, he found this discovery. He was working in India. He was a physician working in India. And he describes, it's beautiful to read this, what he's written. He had his last remaining eyepiece on his microscope was stuck because of all the sweat that was dripping almost off his head, and it had a crack across it from once when he dropped it. That was his last remaining one. He couldn't have servants fanning him because it would blow around the parts of the mosquitoes that he was dissecting. But when he found out that they had thought that malaria spreads from the sulfur fumes in swamps. When he found out that it was in the mosquito stomach, this is a poem that he wrote to his wife on the day that he made this discovery. This day relenting God has placed within my hand a wondrous thing, and God be praised at his command. Seeking his secret deeds with tears and toiling breath, I find thy cunning seeds, O miserable, murdering death. I know this little thing a myriad men will save. O death, where is thy sting, thy victory, O grave? For those of you who are Bible readers, you will recognize immediately that this man is a Bible reader. There's a joy and an excitement that comes by knowing God and walking in science. Beautiful thing. Here's something from my own life. September 3rd, 1993, I became a professor in 1998. I was a professor at the University of South Carolina, and by my third year, I had gotten tenure. I never was even pushing for it. It just fell upon me. My career just took off, God blessed. I was invited back to Purdue, where I'd gotten my PhD, to give a talk. And so I was going to be speaking before my mentor there, and I was praying that morning, and the Lord really began to raise my faith. Because that morning, in my normal passage, I was reading Matthew 21:21. It says, truly I say to you, if you have faith and do not doubt, you'll not only do what was done to the fig tree, but even if you say to this mountain, be taken up and cast into the sea, it will happen. I said, Lord, you're really raising my faith today. You're really raising my faith. I pray that my seminar today in the chemistry department is going to be the best seminar ever in that department. always pray over my seminars, that God would bless. I pray over all my lectures, all my chemistry lectures. I pray over them before I go into class, that the Lord would impact the students. And I was praying that morning. I said, let it be the best ever. And I said, Lord, how am I going to know it's the best? The department's 100 years old. A lot of chemistry seminars. Nobody in there has seen them all except you. How am I going to know it's the best? Lord, I pray that if it's the best, my mentor, the one from whom I got my PhD, would say that it was a super seminar. Here's my mentor, H. Nagishi. He won the Nobel Prize in 2010. 1993, he was just a regular guy. In 2010, now he's a big cheese wherever he goes. When I was a student, no matter what I brought to him, I would think it was really great. I'd show him these results. Big grin, I was so excited. He'd say, pretty good for your level. I never got above the man's waist for your level. None of this for your level stuff, Lord. I pray that he says that it was a super seminar. When I got done giving that seminar, he was sitting right on the front row, right on the end. As soon as I got done, I knew the Lord had blessed. The man just stood up, boom, like a machine, raised his hand. Super! Super! The Lord answers prayer. Right behind him was sitting another man, H.C. Brown, who had won the Nobel Prize in Chemistry for the hydroboration reaction. Nagishi had worked for H.C. Brown. H.C. Brown was in his 80s at the time. I walked up to him, and he was a big cheese at this time, because he had already been a Nobel Prize winner in 1993. And he was sitting down, and I shook his hand, and he held onto my hand. He said, I want to tell you something. That was the best seminar I've ever seen in my life. I said, that's very kind of you to say that. He said, I'm not saying it to be kind. I really mean it. God answers prayer. There's an excitement that comes when you pray. This is not unusual for me. We are working on an artificial retina. It is just amazing. In 4 months, we've got the thing working. It's amazing. Tomorrow morning, if you want, I'll describe to you in the seminar how we do this. Just ask me about it. But there's no external power supply. Right now, artificial retinas cost $100,000. There's 16 bits, just 16 bits. External power supply on your belt with a wire that goes underneath your skin and an RF signal powering. This needs no external power. We just take the photon power, and then after that, it's the action potential from the eye takes over. No wiring, nothing. Just boom, just plop it in right there. 4 months ago, my student, we decided to do this. He's a believer. I said, let's just pray. We fell down on our knees in my office. He said, Lord, I feel like a blind man walking around with a stick. I don't know how to do this. Lord, give us insight. Give us wisdom. Let us make the blind see like Jesus did. 4 months later, we put it on an actual retina and boom, the thing just lights up. It's just amazing. You have faith and you bring it into your work. You see what God does. When I meet students and they don't want to take hold of things in faith, again, I just say, Lord, fine. Whatever they could have had, give it to me. I take it. Your unbelief doesn't bother me a bit. But I'm telling you what will happen if you have faith. Here's the application of the scripture. Once I was upset with a colleague, So my career just took off. Back when we first hired him, I had finished 1 year, then he was hired. We had our separate tenure track slots. And he came into my office one day. I remember he put his arm up on the filing cabinet and he looked at me and says, I'll get tenure before you ever do. Now, in the academic world, that's a really nasty thing to say. That's like walking up to somebody and saying, I'm better looking than you are. Even if it's true, it's an ugly thing to say. And so my career was just taken off, and his was just remaining lowly, like a typical assistant professor and struggling. This one young student came into my office, and she said, you know, you're such a nice guy. I mean, I took your class. This other professor's always saying bad stuff about you. And, you know, the worst thing you can do is tell an undergrad something, and it just spreads like fire through a whole university. They didn't have Twitter back then or Yik Yak or whatever you guys use here. So it took a little longer, but it made its way out through the school newspaper and things. And so I went across the hall and I knocked on his door. I was really going to give it to him. He wasn't in, and as I stood outside his door, God reminded me of this verse that I was memorizing the entire Luke chapter 6 with my kids. And there's this verse: "But I say to you here, love your enemies, do good to those who hate you, bless those who curse you, and pray for those who mistreat you." So I said, "Okay, Lord, I will pray for him. I will pray for him every day." Because I go to the chapel every day and pray. And this is Rutledge Chapel on the University of South Carolina campus. And I would go right up there, fall on my knees, and pray every day. And part of the prayer time, I would pray for him. And his career started taking off. Within a year, he had an NIH grant. Another year, he had another big grant. And he got going so good, going gangbusters. He got an offer from another university, and he left, and I was delighted. And God showed me that I had some cancer in my heart tied up in this situation, and this needed to be extracted. And once it was extracted, then he could give me freedom from this guy. But I had to pray for him every day. I wanted to obey the admonition. So I pondered God a lot. You know, we were once building a synthetic brain. I called it a synthetic brain. It was funded by DARPA. They said, "Don't call it a synthetic brain. We're going to get bad press." So I called it a molecular computer. And then 7 or 8 years later, they had a whole program on the synthetic brain. But it's taking a disordered array of molecules that are interlinked by nanoparticles that have no known order. You can't see the order. Then you start giving voltage pulses at the exterior to try to get it to program to do something useful. It's exactly like a biological system. You have some framework, but a lot is learned in the process. So a child soon learns it's better to put food here than here. This is something that's learned. Can we have a computer do this? And the more we use it, the more the hardware permutes, not software evolving, hardware permutation. Reconfiguring hardware on the fly, sort of like reprogrammable FPGAs for anyone here who's an electronics student. But here we don't know any of the order a priori. We program it to do what we want, and we're working so hard to do this. And then I see this mosquito coming. Tiny little brain, all this coordinated flight, lands, and I just watch it land, eat, fly away, and then all these other mosquitoes start coming, because what it does is it emits now chemicals that tell others, "Hey, there's a fresh piece of meat here, come." Such sophistication in these biological systems. At the same time, my son was about 4 years old. He came running to me, and I'm just looking at this coordination. I said, "Where'd you put it?" He said, "I put it over there." "What did you?" "I put it over there." His brain is perfectly logical. The language is messed up. With short words, we don't put ED at the end. "I will put," "I did put." His brain made the logical thought. Past tense, "I put it over there." And I'm thinking about the biological system and how amazing it is. And I'm trying to make a little AND gate or an OR gate. Some tiny little thing. And so I ponder God in all of this. This is what my science does. It causes me to think about God, to ponder him, to ponder his greatness, especially when I look at what I do compared to what I see in a biological system. Amazing. So what I've talked about is not nanotechnology, my interest in chemistry, my faith in Christ, the decisions and the impacts it's had in my life. And so there's my wife and one of my grandchildren. And with that, I'll open it up for questions.
You've talked about all the things that you've prayed for that have come true.
Yes.
What percentage of things have you prayed for that haven't come true, and could you tell us about some of them?
Sure. This is a terrific question. I don't know the percentage because I haven't kept track, but it is a significant number. And so let me tell you ones, and you, one person may argue, "Well, you'll get it in the future, it'll just come." And there's some that's not the case. They can't come back. So for example, I prayed, because you wanted an example, right? Here's an example. I prayed for the Waterman Award. The Waterman Award is given out by the NSF, to somebody under 40 years old. This is how I know it's not coming back. And I prayed for years for that. $500,000, $500,000 is dropped on your research program. And I prayed it, and I believed it, and I set everything up for it, too. I got the best letter writers to write on my behalf. It was perfectly timed. It was like the Lord timed it for me. Because in the NSF, they distribute it between different disciplines, and coming up, I knew was material science was coming up, and it was perfect for me. And I didn't get it. And so what I do in my life is much like there were three men, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. The Babylonian names were Meshach, Shadrach, and Abednego. They were going to be thrown into the midst of a fire. And they said to King Nebuchadnezzar, "Our God will deliver us from the fire. But even if he doesn't, let it be known to you that we will not follow your false God." And this is my life. Whether God drops on me the things that I pray for or not, I will still worship him and follow him because he is worthy to be worshiped and followed. For me, the blessing is not... You're shaking your head. You asked me, do you want to answer this or do you want me to answer this? You're shaking your...
I'm not allowed to shake my head.
No, I'm just saying that I thought you're disagreeing with me. Okay, so for me, I say, I am going to follow you because you are worthy to be followed. I don't know the percentage. I have prayed for people to live that have died because I feel this is my calling, that I'm going to pray. If people ask me to pray for them, we have MD Anderson Cancer Center in the city of Houston. So people from around the world come to the city of Houston. Our church has a ministry where we have several houses that we allow people and their families to stay free when they're undergoing months of chemotherapy. So I see a lot of people die. I go and I pray for them that God would spare their lives. And many of them still die. I don't know what the percentage is, but there is a significant number. But still I will follow him. I will follow him. Now you're rolling your eyes. Yeah. So this is who I am. Would you like somebody different? This is who I am. You asked me.
No, it doesn't seem scientific because a real scientist would believe that prayer affected events would actually attempt to check this by a controlled experiment.
Okay, so I'm not a real scientist in your view because you said a real scientist would do something different. Absolutely. Not with respect to this, I am not a real scientist because I see miracles occur in the Bible that are contra thermodynamic. And why? That is exactly why we call them miracles.
If you believe, you don't see.
Yes, absolutely. I believe in them. I didn't see what was happening in the Bible. I believe in them. That's exactly right. I'm a man of faith. Most of what I told you about today is based on faith, but it's not a blind faith. There's historical proofs for many of these things. Now you're shaking your head. You are the one who's wrong. If you don't think there's historical proofs for the physical resurrection of Jesus Christ, you haven't studied this, sir. Okay, well, from my studies, there is so much proof for the physical resurrection of Jesus Christ. There are not just me disagrees with you. Many people disagree with you. Absolutely.
So it's not certain.
That is correct.
What did you say it was?
What did I say was certainty?
That it was certain, that the resurrection happened.
Oh, I see. Okay. Point taken.
Thank you for your time.
Okay.
So obviously your approach to God and the Bible has been very positive. You've had great scientific success and so on. I am concerned, seek your advice here, but many Christians in the States who've learned to hate others, and it's led to this great schism in Congress. And you have people, I'm going to call the negative side, like the Koch brothers, who are funding this type of schism. They profess to be Christians, various candidates running as Republican profess Christ and so on, and yet they're bringing about a world in which I think we may destroy ourselves. So these Christians have to learn to practice their Christianity in a way that's more viable for the world. I'm just wondering how those people might be reached so that your example and the example of perhaps a number of other people that practice in much the same way can be brought to them so they will be in effect reborn and practice differently so that our world increases its viability rather than radically decreasing its viability.
Here's sensitive man, and I can see that, and that's a sincere question. You know, I don't have an answer for the actions of all Christians, and I don't even have a litmus test for Christians. You know, the Bible says that if you confess that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that he's risen from the dead, you shall be saved. It interestingly doesn't say, and if you don't, you won't. I don't really know how to assess people in what they say. And I know exactly what you're saying, because what you see here in Canada about what's going on in the political environment, I see at least 10 times more of it. And I've lived in all regions of the country. I grew up in New York. I've studied on the West Coast at Stanford. I've studied in the Midwest. I've been in the Deep South in South Carolina. I've been in the Southwest now in Texas. So I've lived in different regions of the country, and certainly there are different thoughts in general as you go to different regions of the country. I don't have a good answer for you, but one of the things that I try to tell students is that I never speak about politics. You know, I vote, so I do care. So I vote. I just voted yesterday. Today's Wednesday, yeah. So I just voted yesterday on Super Tuesday. Texas voted. So I voted, so I do care. But I never will bring up a political issue in a Bible study. I never do. Because what I feel is it alienates people unnecessarily. So for me, that's not where I go. If I can leave them with the gospel, if I can leave them with the Bible, and so what I want to do with young people is I want to bring them back to the Bible and say, you read this, here's your manual. This is what will make you more like Christ. You don't want to become like me, you want to become like Christ. I mean, that man was just amazing. And so I bring them back to the Bible. I don't think that I'm addressing all that you want me to address, but I don't think I'm capable.
Would like you to expound more upon miracles in your work, and I see that you're guided by discipline and methodology in your science.
Yes.
But I can't help but think that sometimes your prayers are exceeded.
My prayers are exceeded. Is that what you said?
Miracles. You get more from God than just what you pray for.
That is for certain, but he doesn't break the laws of thermodynamics in my lab.
Yeah.
No. So when I pray, I'm not asking him to do something for that experiment that wouldn't happen if someone else ran it. That's not what I'm asking for. The scriptures say that darkness and the light are the same to God. Why would it say that? It means that he sees where we don't see. So what I'm asking him to do is to give me guidance to see what other things don't, where other people don't see. I have given you just a tiny little taste. Look, I have so many advances, so many patents licensed, so many things that I've developed that I shouldn't, that one man just doesn't generally get this. Now, there are a few in this world that have got, but even simple things. I wanted to develop a new corrosion inhibitor. Corrosion inhibitors are really big in the oil field. You know, you go on the coast, things corrode. I went to the lab with my son. I said, we're going to make a corrosion inhibitor. He was about 15 at the time. So we're mixing stuff up. He says, Dad, how long is this going to take? I said, I don't know, 6 or 8 months, we'll come up with something. 6 or 8 months? I have a life. He never came back. But in 6 or 8 months, I really got something that was amazing, and I sold it for a lot of money to a company, and they're out commercializing it. And all I was doing is as I was, Lord, show me what I need to do to protect these surfaces. So in many ways, I'm interacting God with my science, but I'm never asking him to violate laws of thermodynamics. I'm asking him to give me insight to see where other people haven't seen before. Because any scientist will tell you, we live on the edge of amazing discoveries and we just miss them. And once in a while, we swerve into something and we're like, wow. I mean, this is a science paper right here, and I swerved right into it. I want him to make it so I swerve into these things, but it's real science. But I can see what's troubling you in the sense that I don't view what he's done as a miracle in that sense. He's not changed the laws of thermodynamics like real miracles occurred, like a resurrection, like a virgin birth. Those are miracles in that the laws of thermodynamics were changed. I'm never praying for that in particular. Now, there are sick people that I pray that they will live. I feel that's my calling. The outcome of that is in God's hands. Have some of them lived? Yes. Would they have lived anyway? I can't know that. There's no way I could know that.
Thank you for sharing with us tonight. I have a question. You talked about looking at the resurrection and studying the resurrection.
Yes.
What about, sort of two questions, I guess. One, what about the virgin birth? And then a second issue, if you just, probably you could go on for days about that.
Yes.
A second issue too, have you ever come across discovery or scientific insight that makes you wonder whether it's ethical in terms of our biblical principles? So those two things.
Oh, yes. So let me answer the second one first. So the ethical issues. I mean, even just this past Sunday, I was sitting in at my kitchen table with a medical school student who's thinking of becoming a urologist and asking me about, so what happens is you take these eggs, the woman's egg, and you fertilize it ex vivo in a dish, and you let them divide and divide and divide till you get 64 or so, right about there about, and you see which ones are looking the healthiest. And then you take two of three of those and you implant them in the woman. But there's many that have been fertilized now and are dividing and dividing. And then what happens to those? So they generally get frozen and then they get discarded. He says, what do you think about that? He said, these are real serious scientific and ethical issues. I said, my wife and I never had much trouble having children. I'm not going to judge anybody who's not had children. I don't see anything wrong with having this implantation where you mix it in this way and then implant it specifically the ones that are looking quite good. What do you do with all these extras? What do you do with all these extras now? Because if indeed life is at the moment of conception, and I treasure life, and I want to protect life, the life of the unborn, the life of the prisoner. I did prison ministry in a maximum security prison for 10 years, and I've come out of that. I don't want prisoners executed, even if they were mass murderers, because I say we value life. We value life. We have systems where we can keep them locked away forever, but we don't touch life. That's how much I value life. This is a hard question. Should he become a urologist where he has to make this decision and make these cuts and to say what ones are going on and what ones aren't? And all I could say to him is, you need to pray. You need to ask the Lord. I am not God. I am not your prophet. You need to pray and you need to seek the Lord. But I'll tell you, you don't have to, in urology, do that. You can do other parts of urology. That one has huge, huge ethical issues that you need to ponder. Now, your other question was the virgin birth. This was prophesied in the Old Testament, and this is what the New Testament gives record to. So I believe it. Can I put it under my microscope and confirm it? The answer is no. I'm a man of faith. But I see the prophecy of what would come forth. And you read the genealogies, they're stellar, absolutely stellar. Jesus was related to Daniel. Related to Daniel, so from the seed of both through his mother and his father. Father being God, his mother being Mary, but also through his earthly Mary's husband, Joseph, he was related. But if he had been only related through Joseph, he would have been disqualified because of a curse to Jeconiah. God said he cut off that line, and so he redid it through Nathan, David's other son, not through the line of Solomon, but through Nathan. You read this, it's extraordinary, extraordinary on the way this was pulled off. It's fascinating. But it's a miracle. It's a miracle. Oh, yeah. Biologically, this doesn't happen. Yeah.
I'm just wondering, what sect or denomination of Christianity do you belong to?
Right.
And I'm also wondering, how do you get to that denomination based on your reading or interpretation of the Bible? And do you ever worry for example, I often hear Protestants say, go to like a verse in Luke or something like that, where he says that not everyone who professes to believe in me will be saved or something like that. So do you ever worry that you might have been misinterpreting a certain key doctrine, and falsely following Christ or something?
Right. Okay, so on the last question, the answer is no. I never think I'm part of that group.
Okay.
I feel the depth of my relationship. I love the Lord so much. With every fiber of my being, I love him. I'm a Messianic Jew. That means a Jew who believes that Jesus is the Messiah. I am not part of any denomination. I am a member of a congregation, of a church body that has multiple churches around the city because it's grown beyond its initial bounds. It started with Baptist roots, but I am not a Baptist. I don't even know what Baptist bylaws are. They don't put that upon me, and I don't pick it up. So if I'm anything, I'm a Messianic Jew, just like all the apostles were. You know, they were all Jews. People say, how can you be a Jew and believe this Christianity stuff? I'm like, how can you be a Gentile and believe it? It's so Jewish. You read the Gospels, they're so Jewish. It was all Jews there. It's all Jews. And then the Gentiles didn't start coming in until Acts chapter 9. And it was in Acts chapter 15 that they started to figure out what to do with these Gentiles. Up until then, they thought they had to make them Jews first before they could come to know Jesus. It was confusing. How do you deal with Gentiles coming to faith? So I'm amazed that Gentiles come to faith in Jesus the Messiah. Yeah, I really am. What's the attraction to you guys? Jesus is so Jewish. I mean, you're all following this Jewish guy, Jesus.
I actually did nanotech and technology engineering at Waterloo. So, and then I'm like also a devout believer in God. So like, oh, this lecture is awesome.
Well, good. Good. We share that then.
Yeah. And actually, I've been nodding to like pretty much everything you're saying. But I come from a Muslim background.
Yes.
And a lot of what you said, I realize a lot of people like to focus on like the differences, but yes, there's a lot of common grounds.
Mm-hmm.
Lots of common grounds. Like pretty much everything you were saying, I've been nodding to. Just small thing was that we believe in, probably, you know, we believe in Jesus, and we believe that he's the Messiah, and believe Jews are to accept Jesus as a Messiah and all that. But the only difference is that we don't believe him to be God or divine, that he's subordinate to God, like he's a miracle, right? So my question was, I don't want to do a theological debate, but you cited a lot of scientists in your that believe in God.
I cited, referenced.
And I like that.
Right.
But there's one particular scientist that I got me really intrigued, which is Isaac Newton.
Yes.
So he also a strong believer in God. He studied the Bible like thoroughly.
Yes.
That one thing people don't know much about.
Okay.
But he came to a different conclusion, that he believed that Jesus was subordinate to God. So he was, I would say, almost like Unitarian, I believe.
Okay, I don't know Isaac Newton's beliefs, so I don't know. This is new to me. I don't know. Okay.
But all right. So what's your like biblical evidence for Jesus to be God? Like, because could it be a different interpretation? Like, for example, Newton interpreted differently.
Yeah. What? So the whole idea is how can a man die for my sin unless he's a perfect man? God promised in the Old Testament that by his own arm, he would save us. So God takes the...
Could that be a metaphorical statement? Or sorry.
No. Of course it could be metaphorical. Of course it is metaphorical. I mean, he says, by my own arm, and I am saying that Jesus... So it's of course it's metaphorical. By his own arm, he saves us. So the evidence that he goes on and on in the scriptures is that the Son of God is going to come. There are several references to the Son in the Old Testament. It says, kiss the Son. And then it says again in Proverbs, that in Psalms, talking about the Son. But many references to the Son of God. You look at the death on the cross. You look at the resurrection. These are some of the most vivid passages. By his own arm he has delivered us. It is the perfectness of God himself that delivers us. There is no problem for God being in heaven. You know, God can take on multiple places at a time. You agree there, right? God can be in multiple places at one time, or he's restricted like you and me just to this room, and then he's not with anybody else. Yeah, he's in multiple places at one time, yes.
We don't believe God has form or shape, or he's like
right.
Infinite.
So he can be everywhere. He can be in multiple places at a time. He can be up in heaven. He can be on the earth in the form of a man. He is God. He is God. He is able to do this. He is not restricted in this way. He was here on earth, walking in earth. He was residing in heaven simultaneously. God can be in two places at once. This is not a problem theologically.
Okay.
So God is in multiple places at a time, and it is he himself that has died for us. It is he himself that has died on the cross for us. Jesus himself died for us. He came in the form of a man. Okay. He was born in the form of a man. He died as a man, and he resurrected as a man at the same time that he resided in heaven. That is not a theological problem for us at all.
Okay. Can I have one last comment?
Okay.
Because you were mentioning that only like all other religions don't believe that, we all believe that the good deeds is what enters us into
yes.
heaven.
Yes, yes.
So just a correction, we don't believe that good deeds will enter us into heaven. We believe only the mercy of God. Like God's rahmah, grace of God, mm-hmm. but the good deeds is what will help us go in higher levels. But yeah, this is a common misconception.
I see. So it's the mercy that gets
mercy
you in,
of God is more interesting
but the deeds get you higher. Okay.
Like even if you spend the whole life doing good deeds, and an eternity in heaven is completely it's not fair. It's okay. You did like a limited. You have a limited lifetime. You spend 60 years in life, for example, doing good deeds, but in response to get an eternity. So it's not like
I understand.
God's mercy.
I understand. You're going to have to teach some of your Muslim brothers that, because they've told me just the opposite. They've told me that if your good deeds outweigh your bad deeds. So many of your Muslim brothers are confused on that point.
Okay.
But I accept your point if you tell me that that's the way it is. I'm just telling you that just like many Christians don't know many things about their own faith.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Okay, thank you. Thanks a lot.
Hello, good evening, sir. My name is Sunny. I'm a first-year computer science student. Thanks for coming to URLU. And I just have a question regarding the literal interpretation of the Bible. So, like, we all know if we interpret the Bible literally, that it conflicts with the modern science a lot. And I know there are various organizations that want to solve that. On the one hand, there's Ezra in Genesis. And on the other hand, there are organizations like BioLogos. So when you're doing your research that doesn't necessarily is in harmony with the literary interpretation of the Bible, how do you solve that conflict?
So are you speaking, for example, about the age of the earth and things like this? This is what you're referring to, because I want to make sure we're dealing with the same sorts of points. So, you know, this is a very interesting question. You know, there's many cultures. So, for example, my son-in-law is a Messianic Jew born in Israel. When he reads Genesis, he looks at this as an amazing piece of literature. Now, he loves the Lord, but he looks at it also as an amazing piece of literature, and he He's amazed that Western scientists try to pull out from the book of Genesis literal things concerning the age of the universe and the sequence of things. All right, so that's interesting to him. So I tell you, there's a whole segment of the world that doesn't struggle with this. Now, what Messianic Jews in Israel struggle with, we look at and we think, why are you even struggling about it? They have their own struggles. On the other side of that, you know, there's these interesting writings by a man named Gerald Schroeder. If you were to just Google Gerald Schroeder, doesn't matter how you spell it, Gerald Schroeder, Age of the Universe, you would pull up a document that Gerald Schroeder wrote. He is a Jew. He is not a Christian. He is a physicist living in Jerusalem. And he wrote something on the age of the universe, and then he followed that up by a book. But you can just read this 3 or 4 page document that he wrote. It's really quite interesting, really amazing. So one of the things that people say, okay, was the book of Genesis, were those days literal 24-hour days, or were they longer periods of time? So young earth creationists, many Christians are young earth creationists, they take them as literal 24-hour days, so they get the earth being somewhere around 7,000 years old, sub 10,000 years old. There's others that take them being periods of time, because it's not until day 4 that there's a sun in the sky. And so how do you have a day before there's a sun? But Gerald Schroeder solves all of this. Really has a solution to all of this. It's really amazing. Both the young earth and the old earth creationists are right. They're both right. How can they both be right? Wait. And he gets back to the relativity of time. We have an expanding universe. So we know our universe is expanding, right? The universe, you're going to nod with me? Are you okay with this? We have an expanding universe. That's why today is a longer day than yesterday. Days increase because our universe is expanding by a very small amount. But they increase because we're an expanding universe. This, any scientist is going to agree that we have an expanding universe. So, because we're expanding, in the early parts of time when the universe birthed, things were happening very, very quickly, and then they got progressively, as the days got longer and longer. If you just track back by the relativity of time, what looks to us like huge amount of time, when we look back now, it's huge amounts of time. At that point in time, when you understand that time is relative to where you are in the expansion of the universe, things are happening at a very different rate. And when you compare the two rates, and that's exactly what he does, and there's been scientists that compare the two rates based on where we are in the universe, in the expansion of the universe of time. They're very close. So that man as we know man, humankind as we know humankind, is sub 100,000 years old. That most scientists will agree with. In other words, there were certainly bipedal creatures, but human beings as we know them, to be burying the dead, to be playing musical instruments, are sub 100,000 years old. Many will even say sub 50,000 years old. So as far as humankind goes, the difference between 50 or 100,000 years and 10,000 years is in the noise. These are really very small differences when we're talking about eternity. So the numbers of where we are as humans, where the Bible describes where we are, where we're human beings, and where we find, just from our fossil record, of where people were burying the dead, where they had religious experiences, where they were buried, in other words, where they buried people with trinkets along with them, so there were religious thought. This is sub 100,000 years old. Those time frames are actually very close. If you look at these longer time frames, it's not, you can deal with lots of these issues just by the relativity of time. And this isn't my idea. This is the thought of Gerald Schroeder, a Jew, who came up with this. It's really remarkable, and I encourage you to read it. So what looks to us like huge discord today, like how could this be? It's not until there are these other discoveries that tell us, hey, maybe it's kind of right. And I'll give you an example from the recent past, the very recent past, where we had these two black holes coming together, and you saw this ripple in the universe that was predicted by Einstein. And lo and behold, now they've seen it. This is a huge advance. You know, so there are things that we understand later on that we don't even understand now, that to the mind of where we are now looks ridiculous, but to mind of where we will be may not be that ridiculous. And then I sent this off to a statistician, Gerald Schroeder's arguments. And this statistician is a believer in Jesus Christ. And what he did is he started computing then the dates of where science says the different animals came into the kingdoms, where different things, where the plants started coming. And then he started comparing that to the biblical record and using the relativity of time. And he says, this stuff is amazingly close. I didn't have the mathematical ability to do what he did. But I'm just telling you, it's an amazing argument. And I think now Schroeder has dealt with all of this in his recent book. Okay?
Sorry, just on top of that, like, let's say even we can reconcile the time difference. Like, could you give me a yes or no answer of whether you believe a theistic evolution or a direct creation of Adam and Eve?
All right, so how about I do this? First of all, I tell you to come back tomorrow night where I'll deal with the origin of life. But second of all, I don't see a chemical model for evolution as we know it. In other words, I don't see chemically a pathway for evolution as we know it, as we teach it in schools, that they say anybody can understand this, a high school student. I don't understand it. So I am one of the best in the world at making molecules, not by my own judgment, but by what my peers have judged. Not only do I build molecules, I build nanosystems. I take molecules and I know what it is to build a system. Every time I sit alone in a room with a scientist and I ask them, do you understand the details, the chemical details behind evolution of a complex system? Any chemist I meet, not just me, they say no. Why is it that the chemists can't understand this? If you feed this in and out of this box comes this, that's fine. But if you want to say, how does the chemistry occur? I have real problems with Darwinian evolution of random mutagenesis and time being able to solve all the monumental barriers that are there. And to exclude chemistry from this is a big, big problem. And I've had conversations even with Francis Collins, the head of the NIH, the one who heads the Human Genome Project. So even he and I have had conversations on this. He's a biologist. And he says, oh, it's all worked out. I said, the chemistry, yeah, it's all worked out. I said, send me a paper. He said, I'm going to send you papers on this. He sent me two papers. I said, it's got to have molecular structure. I got to see the molecules. Remember, I see molecules in everything. When I look in your eyes, boom, I see molecules. He sent me papers. There were no molecules. It was a bunch of fish heads. There's no chemistry behind it. So I don't see a chemical explanation for it. It doesn't make chemical sense to me. This has nothing to do with faith, nothing to do with the gospel, nothing to do with the book of Genesis. You want a scientific explanation? I don't see a chemical pathway for evolution of a complex system through random mutagenesis and time. Okay?
Okay, I think this is a good moment to bring this evening to a close. As Professor Tuer mentioned, he will be here tomorrow evening at 7:30 speaking on the origin of life, an inside story. And he also has a couple of seminars tomorrow during the day. All the details are in your program or in the posters around the university. So please join me in thanking Professor Tuer once again.